$1,000 in my bank account.
I never had that much back.
I just got back from the doctor, and the doctor told me I've got cancer. If I have enough faith, will God heal me every time? So when you read a text like this, what's the balance between reality and what may be an immature understanding of what James is saying? The first and easiest thing is that when we ask, are we asking from a selfish motive? A selfish motive is not a motive that will allow God to work in your life, right? Just because God says that He will heal you, James says that if you have anybody sick, bring the elders, let them pray, right? Does that mean they will always be healed? The answer is yes. Yes, but it may not be the healing you're thinking about. Because we're thinking, you take this disease away from me, I will be healed. But what you need to understand is people that are sick are not just sick in the body, but they're sick in the spirit, and God will bring healing. Amen. Right? Yes. Yes.
Was that an example or was that a personal fact?
Both. We had this lady in Belzona Church who had cancer. And we went to her house, and it was two pastors and myself. They wanted me to experience an anointing service. And we went to her house, and she was in her bed. And they didn't give her much time to live. And we had an anointing service over her. We put the oil on her, we prayed for her. And within 2 weeks, she was healed. We also did the same thing with another man who was in a bed, who had a cancer that was, he would have these things start from his bones and they would come out of his skin. It was like one of the worst things I've ever seen. And they had a healing service over him and he died. What's the difference between the two? Did he not have enough faith? Was there some secret sin? There was no sin he was doing because he couldn't get out of bed. Did a healing take place? Yes. He was prepared to see Jesus. He was prepared to rest in the grave. So he was healed. See the two? We do not have the privilege to see inside of a person's heart. We don't see what kind of healing they really need. But God's word is sure, and it is always right. Right?
Amen.
Okay, so, but let him ask in faith, with no doubting, for he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive what? That's what I love about James. James lays it right out. James, sometimes you're thinking, wow, this guy's harsh. But you start to understand what James is saying. If you look at it today, with the condition of Christianity today, and the book of James is the book that the churches need to read and hear and understand. Tells it very clearly. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord, for he is double-minded, unstable in all his ways. Now listen, let's go down to verse 13. Let no one say when he is tempted that I am tempted by God. Right? For God cannot, what?
Be tempted, right?
For God cannot be tempted by anyone, nor does God himself, what? Now, what's the difference between tempts and what you find in verse 3?
Test.
There you go. What's that word?
Test.
The two T words. What's the difference between tempting and testing? Because the Bible just there told you that God does not tempt you, but God will test you. Is that right? So what's the difference?
Tempting would be enticing somebody that you want to entice them to do something.
That's what the devil does, right?
Evil, okay? Where God, an example of testing that I like to use is if if God builds this bridge that goes over this great canyon, it has to be tested to know that that train that's coming is going to be okay on that bridge.
The bridge is strong enough to hold the weight.
It has to be tested. And that's where God does it.
Now, is the testing for God's benefit?
No.
God knows everything, so you understand this. I said this before, and I'll say it again. The testing comes to show you where your walk is with Christ. It's not to show God where your walk is. It is to show you. When God allowed Satan to do all those things to Job, did God test Job because God didn't know where Job's faith was? Right? But who needed to know? Who needed to have a better understanding of what righteousness by faith really was? It was Job himself, right? Job himself. So Job was tested to show Job where his... Didn't you ever wonder why when God finally came and talked to Job, he didn't hug him? Now, if anybody needed a hug, it would have been Job. But Job needed to learn something about God. And we need to learn that same thing. And that is that God is sovereign. And God does not answer to us, but we answer to Him.
Amen.
You guys understand that?
Praise Him.
Now, aren't you glad He's sovereign?
Yes.
Because it means He can't be bought.
Right.
He can't be flattered. He can't be deceived. Because He is sovereign and He is love, then everything that He does and everything that He allows to happen is done for our benefits.
Amen.
Now, there are some things that happen that we won't understand until we get to the other side.
Amen.
Right? Okay, so what does James say about how we sin? He says, let no one, this is verse 13, and then we'll go into 14 and 15. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does He Himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is what?
Drawn
away by his own desires and is enticed. This is why Peter is begging you to abstain from the lustly flesh. Yes. Okay? Because it is your own desires that draw you into sin. Where does it start at?
Heart.
Starts with either the eyes, which go right to the brain, or it starts in the brain, which would be a thought, a desire that you continue to dwell on. Something that you're looking at that you know you shouldn't look at, that you continue to look at. Something that you eat that you know you shouldn't eat, that you continue to eat. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then when desire has what?
Conceived.
It's another word for conceived. It's like giving birth, right? Do you understand now? There's a time lag between conception and birth, right?
Germinating.
Yes. This is why you are told to abstain from those fleshly lusts. Because if you continue in them, they will conceive. And then they will give birth. And what do they give birth to?
Death.
And when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, brings forth what?
Death.
Do not be deceived, my brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, in whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. What does that mean? That means that God is not yin and yang. He is not black and white. He's not light and darkness. God
Hallelujah.
Is pure. Light.
Hallelujah.
He is pure, and He never meant for darkness, for evil, or for sin
Amen.
To touch you and I.
Thank you, Jesus.
Right? Or anyone. Okay, so. Who's hungry? Okay, turn with me real quick, and this is where we'll end for today. Back to 1 Peter chapter 2. So after you get an understanding of what James wrote, let's look at verse 11 again and see if it helps you to understand what Peter's writing. Beloved, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul, having your conduct, what?
Honorable.
Amongst the Gentiles, that's everybody that's around you. Have your conduct honorable, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in that day of visitation. Verse 13, therefore, and I bring you through all of that to bring you to this one word. And this is the hardest word that you will ever try to do. And that word is submit. And isn't that what Christ has called us to do? Is to submit to Him. But yet we fight that every day. There are times when we think we're submitting to Him, when actually we're not. You need to be in a submissive relationship with Him every day. Every second of every day. So, Peter tells us in verse 13, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man. He's not telling you to submit to God, because you should already be there. But if you are submitted to God, then you need to, as servants of Jesus Christ, submit yourself to every, what's that word?
Ordinance.
What is another word for ordinance?
Law.
Say it out.
Law.
Whose law?
Man's
law. That means that the laws of your country, the laws of your state, the laws of your work, your employer, you need to submit to. Easier said than done, right? How many people have you heard say, I don't like this government, I don't like this administration, I'm not going to submit to it? How many people have you heard saying, I don't pay taxes because I don't like where my money's going, and I don't agree with them? You could get any administration in there, they wouldn't pay taxes anyway, because it's not about whether they like the government or not, they are lawbreakers. Submit yourself to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake. Who are you doing it for?
For the Lord's sake.
Now listen. Who wrote this? Peter, right?
Yeah.
Who was in charge of the government in Peter's day?
Rome.
Oh, you have any idea who the Caesar was at that time? I can tell you he wasn't a good one. Because there weren't hardly any good ones. And if you were a Christian, they really weren't good. Paul says the same thing. Persecution is coming. And it's going to come not only from the unbelieving Jews, but it's also going to come from the Roman government. Even though it comes, you're still told to submit to their authority. Because that's what pleases God. Unless it is something that goes against the very law of God itself.
Amen.
Because we should rather obey God than man. Submit yourself to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme. You can put president in there, because that's where we're at today. We don't follow a king. We don't follow a king. But a president. Or unto governors, as unto them that are, oh, here you go, sent by who? Who's the him? The governor? You need to look at that, and you need to look at it clearly, because who is it that actually sets up and deposes governments? Okay, and why are governments set up in the first place? What gave them their authority? They're set up by God Himself to punish evil doers. Even when the government itself is the evildoer, you are told to submit to them as long as it doesn't go against one of God's laws. Right? I haven't seen anywhere in there where it says not paying taxes. It's part of God's law. Or not praying for those who are in authority over you, or not submitting to their authority or showing them respect. Get on the internet and look at what Christians are writing about our government, about your governor, or whoever is in charge or in power. And yet God, through His Word, tells you to pray for them. Submit to them. This is what shows the world that you are truly Christ's.
Amen.
That you are not being drugged into the world system, the political system, but you are above that. But you will still submit to that because you submit to God. Okay? Or to governors, as unto them that are sent by Him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. For so it is the will of God that with well-doing you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. As free men, not using your freedom for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God, honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, and honor the king. Thank God you live in a democracy. If you don't like this king, 2 years from now you can elect another one. Okay? Listen, you need to honor him. Who put him there in the first place? If God sets up governments, this is why you honor him. Because he didn't get in there by accident. And it didn't take God by surprise. But you are Christians. And believe it or not, God does not have a Democratic side and a Republican side of heaven. Okay? Alright, well, I'm done. Listen, think about what I told you this morning. Think about your walk with God. Think about your submission to earthly men. Whether it's your boss at work, whether it's your job, whether it's to your husband or to your wife. Whoever it is, God has called us to be people of submission. Amen. Closing hymn this morning is hymn number 537.